Welcome, welcome to the podcast, Awakening to the Voice of Gaia. I'm Catherine Alexander, and I'm so happy to have you here. I'm going to take you on an amazing journey where you will learn how to come home and how to become a partner to life. Healing the centuries-old wound of separation is not an easy thing, but it can be achieved in seconds. First comes understanding, and then the breaking of old habit patterns. Understanding is an inside job. Breaking patterns takes community. I'll be sharing my story and the resources that got me here, and you are welcome to come back and visit at any time. If you want to go deeper, then joining the Third Way community as you learn to live regeneratively would be a good thing. The shift is as easy as shifting from living on the planet to living with the planet. Easy to say and much harder to do. Life loves life, so there is nothing to fear, just old patterns to change. So join me as we explore the wonderful, amazing biology of life and how that changes everything. So here we go. The self-making world. This is such an exciting title. It really is about autopoiesis. That's the scientific name for this. And it offers tremendous opportunities and earth-shaking changes. It is truly revolutionary in how you think about life. The self-making world. Oh my gosh, what could that possibly be? Self-making? How does that happen? So let's go way, way, way back in time. When there was first life on the planet, and we all know that first life was single-celled organisms, but each cell was a self. It understood its boundaries. It understood what was not it, and it controlled what came through that boundary and what went out of that boundary. So there was an incredible amount of consciousness already inherent in that little cell. It made tons of decisions about how it was going to be in the world, what it liked, what it didn't like. And as time went on, it discovered that there were other life forms that if it combined with them, symbiosis, came together with them in some way, the two of them or the three of them or the four of them would be greater than the sum of the whole. That's an amazing feat. So think about what that means about consciousness. The choices that went into those decisions, the self-monitoring of each self that has to happen to make the whole work, the exchanges that have to be decided on, and the processes created to make that happen. These very tiny, really ridiculously small things were able to come together and to create for themselves, both individually and collectively, a better existence, a better chance to thrive, more creative opportunities. All these are inherent in this very teeny tiny conversation about relationships. What is true about all of these participants, all of these selves, all of these cells, is that they loved life. They wanted more of life. And they trusted that other life beings loved life too. And therefore, together, they could come up with more creative ways to thrive. That is an awesome story. It is just out of sight, boss. Now, I'm not asking you to believe what I say. If you think this is interesting, do your own research. I'm not trying to convince you of anything in this podcast. I'm giving you resources, and I want you to do your own research. But I also would like you to suspend disbelief. Act like what I say is true and see if there's anything here that creates an aha or opens opportunities for you. Because what is true, when we rethink our understanding of life and our understanding of ourselves in life as living beings, identical to everything I'm talking about, new opportunities open up and it becomes clear the kind of change that we need to make, in my view. As these little cells continued to work together and became more complex, the world was born. That is what Gaia is. Her body consists of all of the life forms on this planet working together. Working together to ensure that life continues. Now, in my world, that's called the prime directive. We say that all life creates the conditions that support life. This is from Jeannie Benyus and her biomimicry work. What could be more perfect? If all life created the conditions that supported life, life will thrive. And all life has done this. Except us. I believe that's what the tree of knowledge was in the Bible, that we stepped out of the garden quite literally when we decided not to play the game, that we alone could choose not to support life, that we could only pay attention to ourselves, that we would forget everything else. And we've been doing that for hundreds and thousands of years, frankly. This is not a new thing. It's a very, very old choice that we made. And now we're seeing the results of that. You cannot live on a living planet and not support life. And I would ask you, if you're not supporting life, what are you doing? How would you describe what your actions are if you're not supporting life? In terms of life, all is connected. There is nothing that stands alone. So let's take a short detour into quantum physics. I was really excited to discover this confluence because it's fairly new to me as well. So biocentrism really is standing on the science that has been proved over and over and over again, that the universe and the observer are intertwined. That's a huge, huge statement. And we got there through that slit panel experiment. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, you take a piece of fabric or something and you put two holes in it. You put a screen behind it, and you shoot a photon at that barrier. If nobody pays any attention, then it goes through both holes and creates a specific pattern on the back. Both holes, it's in two places at once. How can this be? So this is what led scientists to believe that it's not a thing, it's a wave of possibilities. Well, and then they said, okay, let's see if we can observe this happening. So when they looked at this process and shot that photon, it went through one hole, only one. The observer influenced the results. And they've done this over and over and over again, and it's always the same. Niels Bohr said, we're not measuring the world, we're creating it. Because the minute we ask it to be something, it is. There's another experiment they did where they took photons. Photons come in pairs. and they each have a different spin. And so they separated them by zillions of miles and changed the spin on one, and instantly the other changed. Now think about that. For something to change that fast, there has to be a consciousness and awareness of the difference in the other. And if it goes so fast, faster than light, then it suggests that mind and matter are united in some kind of way. These are awesome statements, folks. I just can't tell you how awesome they are. If we are connected, mind, matter, universe, consciousness are all one, are all interrelated. That has profound implications for how we should live. Time. Time is an emergent property. That means it comes out of experience. And it comes out of experience because it is built on the observer's ability to remember what happened in the past. If the observer has a past, remembers that, then there becomes a timeline. And they have the ability to preserve that memory. So time is an emergent property. It's not inherent. We have been playing with this since the 1920s. And we have not been able to disprove it in any way at all. It is harder than heck to understand, I'll grant you that. But it has profound implications for who we are and how we are in this wonderful world that we live in. So another way of talking about this is to say that matter dwells in an undetermined state of probability. Remember, I talked about that wave. So if everything's a wave, it only becomes determined by the observer. So it always dwells in possibility. Now that's huge. That means that we have an incredible number of options until we make a choice. And the minute we make a choice, we limit those options. It also means that the universe is fine-tuned for life. Life and the universe are together. You can't have one without the other. I don't know what to say. That's so amazing and fabulous. And it's so key. That is why it's so important that our actions create the conditions that support life. If you don't support life, what are you supporting? Think about that. What does this mean for us, small living creatures that we are? This is a rather complicated sentence. It says there is no self-existing matrix in which physical events occur independent of life. That means that nothing can exist together physically independent of life. It is only life that makes things happen. Now remember when I said everything is indeterminate, depending on the observer? That's where attitude makes the difference. Attitude is the lens that you look through. It shapes what you see. It blinds you to some things and makes other things obvious. The same situation can be viewed in very many ways. And each of them are real. Each of them will have impacts and consequences, which is why two people can go through the same thing, have a different attitude and a different experience. But it is also why, because this is a self-making universe, while you have the option through your attitude to determine what kind of life you want. You can't determine the things that happen to you. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the kind of life, which means the way you see the things that happen to you. It is not about control. We have that capacity. It's quantum physics, folks. That's awesome. That is awesome. And what is equally awesome is that you are unique. There is nobody in the world like you. Now, you know that. And half the times it's shucks. I want to be like, or they want me to be like, or they want me to be. And that's not me. We go through this angst because we have been taught that we are supposed to be the same. Now think about this for a minute. We live in a world filled with trillions of life forms, all making their own decisions, which means that everybody is adjusting to all of the decisions that are being made around them as well. So there's a constant flux and flow and change in life. Does this meet your experience? And then we humans, especially Western humans, try to be like somebody else, be something that we don't really want to be, deny who we are. We're not playing the game. We're not contributing who we are. We talk about gifts and we think about gifts of, oh, I have the skill of being good at math, or I have the skill of knowing the truth when I see it. Well, these all may be true, but everybody who has that skill, and there's like, what, 9 billion of us, you got to think there's one or two more out there, we'll do it differently because we can't do it the same. It is not possible. Nature does not do same. Nature only does difference. Because every cell, every self makes its own choice. And that own choice is the unique gift it offers. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to think about it. You just have to be authentic and true to yourself. When you do that, when you show up as who you are, you're the gift. You have contributed in a way nobody else can. You are unique and you are needed desperately for that uniqueness. Let's think about our bodies, our such beautiful bodies. Each body is composed of trillions of cells. We have liver cells and skin cells and throat cells and toenail cells, and they're all different. And they all came from what? That embryo that was two cells put together. Ah, what an awesome thing to have happen. But remember, each cell is a self. Each cell is doing its own thing. Each cell is loving its life and trying to be the best, most alive thing it can be, given its environment. So I would ask you, what kind of environment are you creating for all the cells and selves that make up you? And then let's talk about our gut. Our gut is not cells from us, and they're not our cells. They're individual bacteria that are their own self. They're separate from us. And yet, if they're not there, we're not here. They help us digest our food. They help us live. They are symbiotic with us. They are making possible our life. as they choose their life. That's amazing. They are all independent selves. This is why you can't, with your mind, make a choice. Because your mind doesn't do it. To talk to your body, to talk to your gut biome, you have to be who you are. You have to come from your essence. You have to come from deep within yourself. You have to come from your heart. And in that discussion, you can very seriously talk to your body and to the biome that you are. And we see this all the time with people who have made choices to get out of illnesses, and they've done it their way. They call them spontaneous healings. They don't do research on it. When I had liver cancer, I made a choice, and the choice I made was to follow physics. Physics says that we're all frequency, right? Everything has its own frequency. And so when things are in harmonic balance, there's a frequency there. When we're sick, that frequency is off key. It's different in some kind of way. So I chose a frequency treatment using music that helped me resonate totally to health. And so those things that weren't healthy disappeared. It took me 18 months. But then when I had the tumor removed, because the tumor was the size of a grapefruit and it did not disappear, when the tumor was removed, I had no cancer. And in fact, now I had liver cancer and they did a biopsy, so I know that's true. When he took out that tumor, I had no cancer in the liver, so he left the liver. Usually they take out 2/3 of your liver because it regenerates. He did not do that. That is astounding. That was in 2005. It was a long time ago. 2006, I had the operation. That was a long time ago. Your mind and your body are connected. And it's not that you think about this. Mostly you feel about something. I discovered in my treatment why I had the cancer I had. And it was because I was in a relationship, I was married to a man, and we would have these intense conversations where, in my view, I was burying my soul and bringing out the most deep truths that I knew to deal with the situation we were talking about. I assumed he was doing the same thing. But after each one of these conversations, I felt totally dismissed. And that was because he was not doing the same thing. He was enjoying the intimacy of the conversation, but had no intentions of changing his mind. So his inability, reluctance, decision not to include, to engage with me, to change with me, to absorb my wisdom, to appreciate my wisdom, to recognize my wisdom, felt to me as being disrespected. And there was an anger about that. Now, I didn't storm around the house. I just felt dismissed. I didn't like it. But that little drop of anger over the years, 15 years, impacted my liver and made me feel like I wasn't worth it, that it didn't matter if I was here. And if you don't feel that you don't matter if you're here, then you choose not to be here. And your body says, fine, we can do that, right? Because that's an agreement that you have with your body. If you want to live truly from here, then you do those experiences that make you feel alive, and your body responds in kind. This is subtle stuff, folks. This is really, really, really subtle. So it takes an awareness and a willingness to listen to yourself and to really go deep inside to find out what's true for you. That frequency treatment helped me do that. That's part of what it did. So I've had that experience. But from everything I've said today, you can see how logically this all makes sense. Now, it's maybe outside of your experience, and it's not something that you can decide to do. It's something you have to really want to do. It's like changing a habit. I don't know how many of you have tried to break a habit. It's really hard. If you cross your arms, do this with me, please. Just cross your arms. And now I would ask you to cross them the other way. Whoa, that's hard. You have to stop and think about it, don't you? And how does it feel? It doesn't feel comfortable. Some of you have already undone your arms because it's just not comfortable. It doesn't feel good. This is change. This is how we change or don't. It takes a lot of work to get to this. And we're not schooled in this. Lots of practice. And there's lots of tools to help you do that. But this is starting to work with life instead of resisting it, stuffing it, pretending it doesn't exist, denying it, pushing it away. That's mostly how our society trains us to work with ourselves and with our life, not to engage in it because we don't trust it. We don't think it's necessary or worth it or whatever story we tell ourselves. But life loves life. If you want to engage with life, if you want to be life, if you want to express life, if you want to experience life, then you have to choose life. And again, if you're not choosing life, what are you choosing? Your attitude says it all. How you feel and see about things. This is why gratitude is so important and so key. Gratitude and appreciation bring you into life, show you the path of life, allow you to see with new eyes, to hear with new ears, things in a terribly different way. I would not do my cancer journey for anything. I learned so much. It totally changed my life, duh. And it was the only way I could have learned that lesson. There's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing to fear from it. You have to engage with it instead of resisting it in order to see the gift. We live in partnership. In partnership with ourselves, with our biome, with our environment, with each other. We have to be in relationship. It's the only way things work. Oh, yeah. So what about control? If it's all in partnership and everybody's making their own decisions and we're all adjusting to each other's decisions, where's the control? The control is here in your choice. That's the only control you have. And that's actually a joyous space. We get sick trying to control everything else because you can't. It's not possible. And it's not in right relationship. What we call a colonial mindset is simply a power over. The belief that we have the ability to change, to do to something. One of my favorite phrases is that we don't live on the earth. We live with the earth. And that's the shift. We need to learn with people. We're not on them, for them. We're not doing things to them. We're doing things with each other. In co-creation, actually, it's way beyond collaboration. It's in co-creation. And that co-creation shows up the interdependence that we all need to have. We are interdependent with our gut biome. They need us just like we need them. They don't do good outside of us. They need to be here. And we need to have them. But we're two different entities. I mean, that's awesome. But that is how the planet is designed. That's how life happens on this globe that we're on. So when I think of AI and all the incredible energy and resources we put into technology, I mean, I love the internet. I truly do. I truly do. If we lose all our electricity, that's the one thing I want to keep. Because it allows us to connect in ways we've never been able to connect before. And that's awesome. At the same time, so much of our tech is lifeless, quite literally. And we kill so much to make it. We dig up the living earth. We destroy hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of acres of living things, trees and water and plants and animals, because of the waste of the processes we need to use in order to make tech happen. Is this life enhancing? Does this get us closer to ourselves, closer to life, or does it push us away? Why are we so incredibly caught in control? When things are static in nature and are fixed and don't change, they're dead. Life is constantly changing. You do not need control in life. You need simply to agree to create the conditions that support life. And then anything goes that does that. We are free and open to create. And that creativity just naturally emerges because of all the difference that it's got to figure out how to come together. All those choices are unique and creative. Can we learn to let go of that fear? To be in ambiguity, to allow space for other things to have their say, so that we can learn how to make things work together. This takes time. It's not a fast process. It's a slow process. Behind me, there's a forest. That forest is filled with living things. And all of them are trying to figure out what they give and what they receive and how to do that in a way that works for both parties to keep everybody alive. Because that takes time, old growth forests that have been around for hundreds and thousands of years are rich with intelligence because they have finessed those relationships so that things really work. When we come in and cut them down, you can replant. You can replant the same plants, frankly. If you do plant the same plants, it will take at least 3 years for that forest to come together. But if you plant different plants and pay no attention to what you're putting there, it takes years, maybe centuries, for that forest to become a forest again, an entire ecology that is interdependent. Those agreements are not easily reached by any living thing. And over time, they change because everybody's making new decisions all the time. So there's things that flow through the forest. The trees, of course, are planted, but even trees move. You know, it changes depending on elevation and time frame, all those things. life is constantly moving, is constantly changing, because everything is making new choices. And things that worked at one time don't work at another time. Conditions change, all sorts of reasons for making new choices. So we need to keep the ecosystem together so it has the time to make those decisions and become robust in the process. Is our need for control more important than our love of life? Is our need for control more important than our love of life? Life does not exist as a single anything. No cell, no self exists without another cell or self. It is not possible because every living thing must eat. Therefore, it must have another thing to eat. Every cell, every self exists in a community that exists of things like itself and things not like itself. But it's all about the relationship. It's a win-win-win that everything needs to fit. I love the word fit. So you'll hear me say it a lot. It takes time to achieve a good fit. It takes caring. It takes honesty, authenticity. Oh, we can go on and on. The things that are needed to make a good fit, a good relationship between things, to have a symbiotic relationship, a true interdependence where reciprocity is how the flow of information and resources happens. That we become sophisticated and skilled in making that flow and keeping that flow going. How are we creating the conditions that support life? When I talk about fit, this is not new. And it's not something you can actually not do. And that's sort of the problem child, because when we don't pay attention to fit, when we just do it automatically, we're not paying attention to when we're stuffing our authentic self or whether we're projecting an inauthentic self in order to fit. And we're socialized to do both so that everybody else feels comfortable, right? You don't want to be the bad guy. All of those things that tell us that we're not right, not good enough, not able, not whatever. But that's a lie. That's all false information. We are exactly who we are supposed to be, but we need to be who we are supposed to be. And we need to be sensitive to the other life forms around us so that we can fit in a way that all of our actions create the conditions that support life. The prime directive. I call it presencing. It's for me the best word about that because it's being really 100% present and sensitive to all of that. And this takes skill and practice. It's not something that you're going to do overnight. I want to tell you a wonderful story, and I can't remember the tribe, so I'm not going to attempt to say it. But I heard this story and it just struck me. I don't know how many of you are parents. I have been a parent. And think of Africa. And people in Africa have babies just like we do. And they put them on their backs while they're out working in the fields or hunting or doing whatever it is they're doing. And babies pee and poo world over whenever they need to. And the story I heard was that when the mother sensed that, she just took the baby off and held it out, and the baby would pee or poo. And then she put it back on her back. she was so sensitive, she was able to know what the child wanted. Now we have that sensitivity. We don't pay attention to it. We don't really work to make it the skill that it is. We dampen it down instead of making it more refined. But we always know so much more about the world than we allow ourselves to really recognize. If you've ever had a pet, you know that they have emotions and reactions and thoughts just like we do. They emotionally respond. Their bodies respond. We know what that cat is doing because of how its body acts. Our bodies cue us into the feelings we have. You know when you see what someone walk, whether they're happy, sad, dejected. You can pretty much guess how people are feeling just from their postures and the way they act. Animals are like that, and plants are no different. We know sad plants. We know plants that aren't happy. The soil conditions, the air conditions, the water conditions, something's not right. You can tell it because the plant's body reacts in a way that we recognize. So we have that sensitivity. We have that skill. We just shield ourselves from it. We protect ourselves from it. We feel overwhelmed by all these things because we're not accepting of them. We're resisting. We need to treasure that information because that information is life talking to us. In one of my podcasts, I said, what is Earth asking? These are the things the Earth asks. Gaia asks for us to listen, to hear life's needs, to respond to life's needs everywhere we see it, in our own self, in our partners, in our families, in our cities, nation states even. Think about the relationship between nation states. It should be no different. All actions should create the conditions that support life. That's not how we're doing it. How different would our world be if we had governments with that mindset? This is where we're moving, I believe, if we're going to stay on the planet. We have to learn to work with her. She's not going to tolerate anything less. So how does this change life? Time. Time has to slow down. We have to pay attention to these. And this takes time. It takes the ability to pause, to reflect, to just be with things until you're clear. It's a very different lifestyle we're moving into. These are huge, momentous changes. We can't afford to do things that are not life-enhancing. We have to put life first, nature first. So think about your life. How would your day shift change if you had to do something with nature first, with life first? What are those things around you that are connected to supporting life? If those were your priority and everything else came second, how would that shift the life you lead? Notice your language. Our language is so loaded with ways that validate and perpetuate that separation that we're in. The difference between living on Earth and living with Earth is such a great example. It's right there. If you're living on the Earth, you're different, separated from it, able to do things to it. If you're living with Earth, you're in relationship. You're listening. You're working within that time frame, not the human time frame we've constructed. reframe those things that manage that separation. Change on to with. Change to with. And see what difference it makes in your understanding and in the opportunities that are available. It's a dramatic change. Costs nothing. Just your willingness to engage and to slow down, to spend some time on life. So how do you spend your time? It's an interesting question. How much of your time is spent really creating the conditions that support life? How often do you recognize what those are, especially when there's a high emotional charge? I mean, that's one thing about anger and angst and those kinds of emotions. They make us very self-centered, very much concerned with our own condition and not really caring much about anybody else or how we impact anybody else, as long as we could eliminate those emotions from our presence. What a wonderful way to begin to reframe those experiences, to accept those signals as life tapping us on the shoulder for something. And instead of resisting it, which is where those emotions come from, how can you reframe that situation so that it becomes for you an experience that supports life? Thank you for listening. So thanks for listening. I so appreciate your joining me on this journey. To go deeper, check out the Third Way community. The link is on the podcast page and on my own webpage, and you can see it right here. My own webpage is bridgetopartnership.com. You can support my work through donations on my podcast webpage or by joining my Patreon page. I am open to questions and messages, so please connect and be sure to leave your name so that I can reference you when I respond. It's the new mother nature taking over. It's the new splendor lady come to call. It's the new mother nature taking over. She's getting us all. She's getting us all.